afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another exciting Propaganda Cast. With me, your host, Imperial Dane, Master of Propaganda, and a Merry Christmas to you all. For those, anyways, who celebrate, to the rest of you, I don't know, happy 24th of December. Something like that, nice. And a happy another Propaganda Cast, which I'm sure is just, for all of my fans, by the way, just as joyous occasion as Christmas itself. We'll be having a 1-1 Honey and Kolotny Firma Winter, which I'll be watching on one side here. Jesselin fighting for Deutschland, for Germany, for the Brandenburger Panzergrenadier Division going up here versus Paul AD fighting for the Soviet Union for the glory of Comrade Stalin and the Second Guards Mechanized Corps poised to break through the lines and into Germany. And we have got here already armored assault, by the way, chosen by Paul. We got full infantry bulletins for Jesselin. We've got Luftwaffe ground forces, breakthrough, and scavenge here with a bunch of infantry bullets, including one Obersoldaten bulletin. Full scale is on the way. Got the center point here being wired off a bit. Conscripts on the way for Paul. Although we do note there's an early special RAF command here for him, but unlike, say, Red Wings, he does not go for a lot of Strafniki right off the bat. First shots here around fire, then we quickly have the Germans breaking away. We've got a bit of fence bring up, then we've got the constant mix of the building. The Volksgrenadiers find themselves a bit locked outside. Scheiße, Dieter, I told you to lock the door. I don't have the keys to that place. Who do you think I am? Oh, that's right, you're German. Anyways, truck here making a bit of a mess over the fence that some poor farmer Boris once upon a time put up. Painstickingly. Meanwhile, the truck there is driving horribly. But so far, all of the fine seems to be centering on the north south, is seeing very little attention there from either side, except a bit from the Sturmpionier, who even then sort of abandoned it. Nego conscripts out negative, coming confirmed for the Sturmpionier, the Sturmgewehrs firing into there, the conscripts quickly making a run for the fence. Sadly, Yuri never made it. And not afraid to use the buildings, he now sort of basically rendered not very sound to reside in, with only a facade here towards the fuel point, making it look like it's, you know, somewhat decent place to be in. Conscripts and commies are being pushed back by the Volksgrenadiers, is leading the way forwards. Fourth unit on the way for Jesselin. We've got a scout here for Paul. It's an M3A1 American vehicle, courtesy of the Lend-Lease program, on the way there. Points there being secured up here as well. So far, again, very little action towards the south. We've got a bit here with the Sturmpionier now engaging the conscripts. Medium range, light cover, but sadly not quite well now. Got ultimately now pushed back here with the conscripts. Push into there. Ooh, rather a bit risky as well. Rather a bit risky. Conscripts will end up being forced away here by the might of Deutschland. Fuel point here being secured. You got the M3A1 heading north here. Combat engineers joining up. And we've got a mechanized regiment headquarters here for Jesselin. Should provide him with some mechanization if that is what he desires. Yes. He might secure the fuel point again. Very much fighting up. Do see a bit of light now going there. He might be able to secure the fuel point there. In which case, Paul will be able to gain quite a fuel advantage over Jesselin. So there's definitely a bit of an impetus there for Jesselin to quickly do something to secure either point in the name of the Reich. There are no cowards here. Approach on the church, and the Germans do reveal themselves at the same time, though. Down your side to the north. No flamethrowers, though. No flamethrowers. Running straight into the Volksgrenadiers, opening up from all sides. Scout car does suffer some lighter damage as a result of that. Sturmpionier joining in, and we've actually got a sniper here on the way for Paul. Three conscripts, a scout car, and now snipers. An interesting opening there from Paul. And certainly also bold in the regard here with armor assault, but he does again provide him with radio intercept, which does allow him to sort of react more fluidly. Getting into this building, perhaps not the wisest idea. I mean, that might as well be a Potemkin house for all intents and purposes. We do see the troops falling back. Right here, actually, a bit of an interesting decision here by Paul. He runs actually out in front of the broadside of the church, particularly the one with Probably the most windows of anything, so I'm not entirely sure I did, and I'm not even less sure why. Oh, that was probably why the flamethrower they mounted in the scout car provided quite the persuasive argument for abandoning the church. We're now fighting for the victory point for due to a pantry got P4. Jeslin, which I'm doing with the M3A1. You're further fighting for the center. Stuart Pioneer jumping up. We got a bit of resource chain going for so far. No sign of anything here besides it because he doesn't have the fuel for it. He's not for the time being. Paul gaining most of the map now. Looks like he's actually falling back here from northern fuel point. Conscripts moving out, and there we go. We got a flat half track there on the way. With the M3-1 striking it versus the Sturm Pioniere. So there we go, not long to go. In which case, Jesselin might be able to bring out some heavier firepower here to bear versus Paul, while Paul's snipers shoot through the windows in the hopes of catching some unwary soldier through the eye. So far, though, Paul's got Jesselin nicely contained here. Despite Jesselin's best efforts. Despite Jesselin not, for example, say, overextending, but actually trying to say sort of focus it towards centre north. Let's see if the 251-17 flak half track might not be able to turn things around a bit, or at least give Jesselin a bit more breathing space there with his 2 cm flak cannon. Both units are ending up retreating. And we got a support bomb company up there for Paul. Could be certainly a sign that he's going to play for Doctrine Armour. A lot of players do tend to go for a mix of Special Rifle Command and support bomb company. If they do go for Doctrine Armour call-ins, rarely will they go for that. And then say afterwards, get a Tank of Battalion Command. So there's a bit there to sort of consider. I mean, versus the Upper Command, West Batista, the way he's probably been able to sort of keep Jesson from gaining a lot of territory, it might work out better than say versus the Wehrmacht, who could be able to punish it. Though to a certain extent it will also depend on Jesselin actually getting something done here, probably with his flak half track and actually doing some serious damage to his opponent. I mean, that's really his best damage or opportunity to sort of damage Paul with it and basically punish his strategy here, which he does seem very intent on sort of pursuing. I believe that's a bit of attack round. He must have seen something down there which gave him cause to sort of basically fire down there. Slowly inching forward, scout car striking it, making it through the south. And catching a few unready Volkskanadiers by surprise and quickly burning down Jürgen. Enemy fire! Take cover! Snipers want to approach him. Got a field gun here on the way to deal with the flak half track. Conscripts inside the building. Might soon get an eviction notice there from the flak half track, and there we go. The sturdy walls will end up nicely protecting the occupants there. It looks like Paul is going to try and push up things here from the south. He could also apply a bit more pressure from the north. Looks like he's finally moving in some troops to do that. Certainly a head-on assault here against the flak half tank would be somewhat akin to suicide. Unless he's had the sufficient firepower to basically quickly deal with it. So far, Jesselin seems to be acting northwards here. Meanwhile, we've got a bit of larger action here. The Volkskanadiers do manage to keep Paul's troops a bit at bay. Bit. The problem with the flak half track, of course, is its setup time, which does mean you have to be a bit more careful with it if you sort of really want to get anything where to basically hope you can sort of set up in a position where your opponent can sort of be drawn into the fire. I mean, it's only really an edge to that the flak half track really sort of becomes a more offensive weapon once its setup time basically becomes so short it doesn't really matter, because otherwise, I mean, before that point, it is a noticeable setup time, which does give your opponent plenty of time to react. In this case, still a bit of fire then connecting with the flak half track, forcing it away. Volkskanadiers, oh, almost getting wiped out there, almost, and yeah, that's, oh! Oh, sadly, Gustav there did not have the luck to avoid death. Battle group headquarters up for Jesselin, and we also got Scavenge there, chosen opting up there for Jaeger Infantry, in which case you could try and surprise the snipers, if you so fancied. Finally, to the north, we do have a bit more of a serious push in from Paul. 2 conscript squads now mobilized. The glory of Comrade Stalin while the snipers continue the incessant sniping here in the center. Slowly draining Jessalyn of life. And there we go. Yeeks appearing and springing a surprise there on the sniper. So do get out of there reasonably quickly, though not before the Jaegers actually gain almost halfway to Veterancy 1 and go for the cut-off point. At the same time, got lots of control. We've got a built use there, and he's actually sending it. Oh, can't help but feel this is a bit of a mistake here by Jessalyn. He's sending in a half track into the Blizzard rather than the blind here. In this case, it gets easily surrounded here by conscripts from all sides. There you go, destroyed it. We got Stuart Puny attacking from North, but overall, I mean, this doesn't exactly look good for it. And there we go, ultimately, the flak half track here is lost. Not entirely sure why Jessalyn said it in unscreened like that. Had he at least had some infantry to sort of check the way, he might have been able to sort of better protect it. But ultimately, he did not, and the lost result was that. But it's not too uncommon to see, basically, at some point, basically, people just tend to sort of try and rush it in, and that usually tends to get the flak half track wrecked. Which is a bit sad to see, particularly when he does hit veterans. Some players do get a bit overexcited, and that really tends to sort of result in some half tracks getting rendered utterly useless. Bit of lighter skirmishing here. Paul managed to cut off a lot of resources there from Jessalyn. Max gaining the second fuel point. That's going to be a bit of a problem there, particularly since, again, Paul is seemingly playing for the Doctrine Arm, in which case, the more fuel he can get, the better. Though, again, a fuel catch then might also be. You've got another cut score there. Arriving Scout Car finally went down. Looks like the occupants as well met a horrible fate. Snaps are pulling. And we got another Jaeger unit arriving. Looks like, in this case, Paul, though, senses danger and managed to get them on retreat there. Question is, though, can the Jaegers at least get one unit in the process? There we go. One sniper did go down here to the Jaegers. Sharp marksman fire. Ultimately, they will be all wounded, forced away. You got Jaegers supporting the Foxes here by the front. There we go. Grenade going off, wiping out the Conscript Squad. Definite loss there to Paul, though certainly not quite as much as the flak half track, which he probably should aim to salvage as soon as possible, both for the fuel but also the munitions. Shu Mina going down there. Field gun is escaping the wrath here of Jessalyn's Jaegers. Beyond that, not a lot seems to be going on here. Troops running back and forth. We've got a third track there, but doing nothing. Interesting enough, he stopped the resource rate for the time being. And he actually abandons the fuel point right after laying down the mine. Not entirely sure there what Jessalyn is thinking. Seems a bit hasty. And Jaegers, they neatly suffered in sniper fire. Fritz went down there. Looks like Heinz soon will be joining Fritz. It's a bit of quiet here as forces are being rebuilt, reorganized, and a lot of other things. And there he goes, salvaging. Stuart Puny right now getting back to the fuel point. There might have been a misclick then from Jessalyn. Support up of snipers, not bad. Also pressure in the south. He might again sort of try and switch over something to the north there again to try and draw some forces of Jessalyn up there. But overall, right now, Jessalyn needs to sort of put in some a bit more pressure here towards the center and try to outmaneuver Paul that way. More Pantrix on the way there and more sniper fire. The problem is definitely taking quite a peppering there from the snipers, but still, looks like Jessalyn is very much intent. Ultimately, though, falling back there. Oh, looks like a flamethrower there was actually secured by the Volksgrenadiere. And getting that scout car there salvaged as well. That's about 30 munitions well from those two vehicles, plus 10 fuel. Not too bad there. Veterancy 1. Paul there keeps up mainly pressure in the center, lighter action in the north. Maybe a little to the south here, which does give Jessalyn an opening to strike up there. I'm trying to apply a bit more pressure. That's also forcing the sniper to be a bit more cautious. But interesting enough, he's still not hanging around that building. He could give an opening here again for Jessalyn to pop another Jaeger unit. Then again, that would give him a bit much infantry there. So, of course, it might be an argument for not doing it. One thing I really think, though, Jessalyn should consider is that using some of those Jaegers to lay down booby traps, in particular around this fuel point here, so it can make it a bit harder for Paul to sort of constantly harass it, not without suffering some more notable casualties. At least be my opinion on the subject matter. Paul otherwise basically sort of playing with the same unit mount he has until he can get the armor. Though again, a fuel cache for somebody at the cutoff point might prove to be a wise idea. Or a munitions cache to say save up for some Sturmovik attacks or mines or demo charges. Paul does have a notably large amount of munition there floating about, though now he does seem to be sort of going a bit into it there with a quick barrage from the field gun. Just sort of struggling to maintain a large amount of the territory though. Paul usually striking back rather rapidly, plus the sniper seed draining away constantly does make it a bit harder here for Jeslin to maintain a solid frontline presence. There's no sign of taking up here though. Could it be he might be playing for some from either the mechanized regiment or the battle group headquarters? A Puma, I suppose, could work here. I suppose there's not really much reason for Yak Panzer at the moment, considering their spill. Very little actual armor here. In fact, the flat panzer right now might be a good choice, considering the rather large infantry force here. Though again, question is, of course, does he know what doctrine his opponent's got? Not really. Either way, at 9 command points, he certainly should be expecting his opponent to go for some kind of doctrine calling. Going for the flak panzer is certainly a bit risky. I mean, it's not going to be that long before something doctrine there hits from Paul's side. So it is a bit of a risky maneuver there. I mean, it's really going to come down to how much damage can it do with the flak panzer in that short amount of time before the enemy armor arrives. And can he then keep the flak panzer safe? Because if he can do an alright job, then he can definitely sort of bleed up Paul a lot and keep him a bit more contained and a bit more cautious, which would certainly be to the advantage of Jeslin if he can get some armor out. Then he might really want to consider beginning trading for resources now. And at this point, again, he's just basically set back his anti-tank assets, quite notably an infill basic armor. He definitely needs to sort of try and build up for that again, I would suggest. Although for once, the one a bit on the back foot here with the arrival of the flak panzer, but I imagine that's not going to last long. In fact, not very long until he hits the 11 command point. He's got the fuel, he's almost got the manpower, in which case he can call in the IS-2 here versus Jeslin and give Jeslin there quite the Soviet headache. And there we go. Though he did seem to spend a bit on reinforcement, which might have been a bit silly there, considering how close he was to the IS-2. There you go, flak panzer engaging, trying to hunt down those conscripts and end their lives. Troops slowly sneaking up. Not long there to the IS-2, the Yosef Stalin too. And going for the southern fuel point now as well. Jeslin here getting a bit bolder now with the arrival of the flak panzer. He can sort of control a bit more of the battlefield and also do some more serious and permanent damage there to Paul. Though, now it's Paul's turn to call in something bigger and nastier. The IS-2. Deuce call ready on the way there. And actually he's got already conscripts rushing there, the flak panzer. He could briefly starve it up, but he wasn't going to avoid it. But I imagine he wanted to get as close there to the mechanized regiment as humanly as possible to get it repaired as quickly as possible. And that does immediately happen. Well, he does need to stop it up. And then you got the IS-2 rolling ahead here through the center road. And there's only really infantry here to stop it. He's soon getting into Ken Refer, which helped a bit, but overall that IS-2 is going to be a massive threat there to Jeslin at the current moment. He's still not training for resources. That's definitely going to sort of keep him a bit harder sort of in terms of keeping dealing with it. And there you go, the flak panzer moves straight into the line of fire. Close to the pantry in the nearby building. Does get a bit of damage there done, I think, on the IS-2. But not enough. Not enough by a long shot.
We have an isolated sector.
And there we go. Paul, of course, knows what's coming. Arkadenwerfer. So he's obviously less worried. In the meanwhile, though, Jeslin strikes north here with the flak panzer, realizing it's going to do nothing in the center. Instead of having to deal with any harassers up there, and he does catch a conscript here. Meanwhile, the snipers and the IS-2 press forwards. Wiping out the Fosker is bursting apart the flamethrower tank. A horrible loss right there for Jeslin. A horrible, horrible loss. We've got more troops are moving in. Haunted by Sturm Pionier, straight into the Jaegers and the flak panzer. The losses there to Paul are rather excessive. He might suffer squat loss, it doesn't quite look like it. Either way, the flak panzer is rapidly moving towards Veterans in 1. IS-2 a bit slower here. Still not trailing though for Jeslin. He seems confident he can handle things and does not need to rush for anything. South there, and we got the flak panzer moving there. Jeslin boldly rolling down. Jaeger starts that one. No sign of doctrine, anything, or a fuel cache here from Paul, so there's definitely going to be some time there before the next piece of armor arrives. Oh dear, conscripts in the cold, cold blizzard, and then front of the flak panzer. Though thankfully, Jeslin, at least for him, is moving, which means the flak panzer are a lot less accurate. Being the conscripts, otherwise, they might just man survive. And now we've got the field gun opening up there on the flak panzer as well. If the IS-2 was sailing to hunt it down, which in fact looks like it will, then we got Jeslin doing what he can to cover it up with the Ken Mephis and Punch Strikes. More combat engineers, in fact, good idea there, considering he's got absolutely none left. Which does mean his IS-2 will be rather vulnerable until that happens. Bit of quiet here as the blizzard sets in. Coming in there. Jeslin have a nice chunk of the map now compared to his opponent. And there we go. Jeslin realizing he might have to trade for resources sits about doing so. Good, good. Paul, though, doing nothing to increase his fuel income, though. No fuel caches in his favor. There we go, the snipers have continued to take a terrible toll there in Jeslin's forces. Another poor soul or two wiped out. There we go, Mana engagement up. He could launch a grenade assault there with the Jaegers, but no, instead gets caught there by Molotov. Troops there as well. There we go, flak panzer, veteran to one. 15 kills already. IS-2 moving ahead there. Flak panzer needs to be rather careful. Ooh. Looks like he spotted that Raketenwerfer and opens up on it. Or he's just getting a lucky instinct, I don't know. It's a bit hard to say with all those snipers around as well. Half the air unit down. And sent running.
Crew, get ready. Octo, put it ready.
But it is time for the mid-game analysis. Current situation here is for Jeslin. He's got a bit more scenario to really resist his opponent with, but overall in terms of map control, he's still a bit behind. And in terms sort of something to deal with the IS-2, he's in a bit of a bad position. Well, since a lot of what he has can easily be cleared up by the snipers, and he's got no spare panzer at quarter. I don't really think he can afford to go for it. His options are either going for a Puma or going for a Jagdpanzer IV. Current situation, the Jagdpanzer IV might work, but there's also a field gun which could easily duel with the Jagdpanzer IV and knock it out, and even then the Jagdpanzer IV will struggle with the IS-2, but in this case it might be his best bet. I mean, there's a bit the risk of sort of the strategy here Jeslin played for, going for both the mechanized weapon and the battle group headquarters. Might be he was expecting the T-35s, in which case Pumas would have worked versus the IS-2. That might be a bit too much of a risk there. So in that regard, there's a bit of a headache here. But otherwise, for the time being, it's really going to come down to how much damage you can do with this flak panzer and keep the IS-2 maybe running after that. I mean, you can do a lot of infantry damage to Paul. He can slow down any progress. He can also basically make sure it's going to be very difficult for Paul to get up any fuel caches, which would otherwise speed up the income of armor. But if he does get a Jagdpanzer IV, he does need to be careful with it, he does need to keep it screened and covered from any sort of quick flanks, otherwise Jeslin's Jagdpanzer IV might become a junk panzer rather quickly. As for Paul, he's got a decent force there, he's got initiative, but at the same time he is struggling a bit, then in part of the flak panzer is a bit the cause of the issue here, and he's basically got nothing to really hunt it down. He's also got plenty of munitions. He should, I think, consider some mines here and there. He should also consider fuel cache or two as rapidly as possible to speed up fuel income, and that way speed up his process towards the next heavy tank. Or pair of T-35-5s could also work out quite well. The IS-2 basically sort of acting as at the anvil, whilst the T-Force acts as the hammers, a bit more mobile, hunting down units, and sort of flanking whatever's shooting at the IS-2, so that could actually be an option there for Paul to consider. But mines and demo charges, maybe a mortar would also prove quite helpful here against the defenders, maybe to either just lay down a bombardment or a smoke screen. So a few options there, I think, for Paul he should consider. Otherwise, he needs to keep up the pressure and maybe also try and strike around here, capture a bit and harass, and again force Jesselyn to divert units and attention up there. But beyond that, there's not really much else to comment on at the moment, so we're back to fight we go. Conscripts freezing their asses off as they get sacked. We've got the Benji's under fire from the flak panzer. They've got minesweepers, but each enough, there's not been a lot of mines from Jessen except one, I think. A bit quick resistance there, forces the flak panzer back, even though Kenmef was forced out of the building. Oh, there we go, mine war went off. Almost wiping out the counter squad there. The Sturm Pioneers were not able to finish off the job. Sadly. And it looks like here he's basically knocking out the building and showing that there's nothing there. Jesselyn can use his form of defense there, would say that a Kedenwerfer. Not a bad decision. You got the Jaegers here moving out, charging through the deep snow. And there we go, Yacht Panzer IV on the way. Jesselyn's only real option at this moment, considering it's an IS-2 he's facing off against. And one well supported by snipers and field guns. We also got an airstrike here actually available for Paul. He could consider that, but then should probably wait there until there's sort of decent infantry. Then again, with a flak panzer about. I'm trying to be cautious here for Paul to reconsider. In particular, that flak panzer reaches veteran tier 2, that's actually going to make things very difficult for the aircraft. There we go, IS-2 moving in there. Flak panzer heavily damaged, takes another nasty hit there, constantly getting shredded. Oh, Jaegers moving in, blah, and we got Fulters there. They'll actually get quickly run off there, out of town. We got the Yacht Panzer finally mobilized for the front line here. And he's finally got a fuel cash up here, Mr. Paul. That's definitely going to help him. The Kenmefer gets off hit there. IS-2 misses that up close. Another hit there, gaining veterancy one. They might want to get out and then save the veterancy. Yacht Panzer 4 moves up and fails to penetrate at that range. There we go, one shot went through. Fear gun they're setting up as the Yacht Panzer 4 pursues. And the Yacht Panzer retreats for the time being. Flak Panzer, though, is awfully close to Venture 2, which will definitely make it very much more difficult here for Paul to consider using his airstrikes. We also believe got some self repair there to speed up the repairs of the tank alongside the engineers. Not a bad idea, not a bad idea. Orders come standing by. Send orders. There's definitely an opportunity, I think, for the flak panzer to reach Veteran 2. There we go. Striking south once more. Jesselyn still interesting enough, does help the victory point advantage there versus Paul, because Bolt's never really tried to strike for the northwestern point. Flak panzer does now have Veteran 2, by the way. Increased anti-infantry ability and also anti-aircraft ability there. Jaegers charging in. Molotov's up now, looks like he researched that after a bit of time. Can try and deal a bit more aggressively here with Jesselyn's infantry. Right here, the conscripts are getting pelted with high explosive anti-aircraft munitions. Victory point being secure, and there you go, Jesselyn's going to be gaining a victory point advantage here further versus Paul, who's still relying on that one IS-2, and really seems like he's playing for another. Pardon me, we'd like to see some T-3045s though, for something a bit more mobile to work with it. Otherwise, while his force does have some power, it is a bit more cumbersome and a lot less flexible. Which is something to be wary of, in particular considering that while the Yacht Panzer IV is hardly much more flexible, the Flak Panzer on the other hand is. And it's Veteran T2, which definitely poses to some problem there and promises, certainly even more. So far, Jesselyn seems to be holding a bit back here. Grenade assault here. Though fails to make much of an impression.
The enemy now has 200 points.
Snobs and Conscripts hang about there again. We got the flak panzer moving down. And the Conscripts, by the way, in negative cover. Easily allowing for the flak panzer to tear them apart. Conscripts kneeing up here, trying to catch the Jaegers. Got one down. Ken may have trying to deal with this. So there we go. Flak panzer returns. Like a triumphant hero. Sets about killing more Russians with the murderous gleam. Got the eyes zooming ahead. They're trying to open up. Got the Kenner. Got the Yak Panzer finally on the eyes too. Shots still continue to bounce off from the Yak Panzer. But Kenner having a bit more luck there. Though close to extermination itself. And we got the Flak Panzer almost getting knocked out. Needs to turn about the Yak Panzer to open up there. Shot went through. Halfway there to victory. Three field guns sitting up there. Might contain the Yak Panzer force. Send it back. Flanking there with the Patrick. Gunther does manage to damage the eyes too, but they have to be falling back rather quickly. There's a Snubs advance. We've got one bitch and 37 kills, by the way. Quite an impressive work there. Field gun, on the other hand, less impressive as it can't hit the Yak Panzer 4. Of course, it was a bit harder to hit in the actual war due to its lower profile. But now, Paul is gaining back his territory. Gaining back ground and gaining back some steam there. SGS Lin is being forced back here, though again the Flak Panzer is back on the field and soon the Yak Panzer 4 would also be ready. There's no real serious sign of mines. Oh, there we go, we actually got a demo charge going down here. There we go, Conscript's getting slaughtered there. And a second IS-2 here, adding more punch to Paul's forces. And certainly posing ever more of a problem here to Jeslin, who's only got one Yak Panzer 1, which he's noted already struggles notably with a single IS-2. So 2 is only going to give Jeslin and his tank destroyers there more of a headache. He's otherwise only got Panzerix and I came out to rely on, and the snipers there can definitely cause a bit more problem, in particular the Vetcher 3-1 with a higher rate of fire. Will pose quite a problem. I mean, if Jeslin had some artillery, he could maybe make things work out a bit there. But beyond that, his options are a bit limited unless, say, flanking in with a flak panzer with a combat blitz and kept wiping out the units before the IS-2 can react. But there we go, the IS-2's heading forwards. Sniper's going to pick up the defense, got the field gun covering. And there you go, the flak panzer trying to escape the Yak Panzer force, already pulled back here from the scene of battle. I came up again, victory 2, but that did not last for long. There we go, one hit there from the flak panzer. Or flak Yak panzer. Bloody hell. Yak panzer, flak panzer. Falls a bit together too easily there in terms of words. Yak panzer does manage to gain victory 1, doing a bit of damage to the IS-2s, who continue their spree of violence. We do not, by the way, a spare panzer course that we can adjust them, which could open up for some Orbis from Darden or a Panther. Jaegers almost wiped out there.
Standing by. Send orders.
And the flak panzer being hit there, Veteran to flee. Oh, it's lots of snipers there. I think he should combat blitz actually, right past all of it. No, he might try and get the field gun there before he can get the Yak Panzer. There we go. So close to Veteran 3. There we go. Hits the snipers, including the Veteran, particularly the Veteran 3 one actually. And tries to hunt them down there. Though we got some Conscripts there rushing it, saving the unfortunate snipers. Yak Panzer also trying to escape. We got the IS-2 running down again. Both of them actually pretty damaged here. There might be a chance of the Yak Panzer for actually scoring a kill there. If you Deutsch then gaining victory 2. Increased line of sight and improved armor. But the IS-2 does escape here and gets increasingly closer to victory 2, which does promise more range and accuracy and more problems for the Germans.
Crew, get ready.
Getting awfully close there to victory 4 and 44 kills in the name of Deutschland. Pretty sure someone's going to get some iron crosses inside that one. In fact, it's getting ever closer to Veteran D4, which actually promises more damage. More infantry there, interesting enough. No Jaegers or Orbs are done there, suggesting you'd figure that after you went for the Schwer Panzer at quarters. But at the same time, it does also serve the purpose, I suppose, of guarding the northern victory bodies, ensuring there's something there that's going to be difficult for Paul to secure and actually gain a 3 point there versus him. And there we go. Veteran D4 for the Black Panzer. Each shot will now be notably more lethal. 46 kills there, though. The Flak Panzer is quickly catching up to the snipers.
Standing by.
Actually, I think it has caught up. And outdone some. Now you got the Yak Panzer 4 creeping forts there. Cautious movement. Flak Panzer there making notably less cautious movement as it moves ahead. Go Molotov against the Jaegers. IS-2's moving in. It looks like Paul's preparing for a northern strike. We've got the Flak Panzer rushing in. Yak Panzer 4 will not be able to rush in particular due to cautious movement. He's going to need to cancel that if he wants a chance. But now he continues there nonetheless. Can he maybe get it to Veteran D3? Which would increase its intensity by increasing rate of fire and mobility. And so also make it harder to catch here. A Kedmare fun field gun firing there. Yak Panzer getting off some shots. Field gun crew did get wiped out. And there we go. Counter is hanging here from the side. Flak Panzer needs to serve in. Stop them. There we go. Damaged engine. The IS-2s are rolling ahead. But Kedmare have them firing away. And there we go. Veteran 2 for the IS-2 increasing its range and accuracy. Although, yeah, two that continues on less. Yak Panzer 4 is a bit of trouble. Flak Panzer leading the infantry down south. 57 kills! 59! Trying here to save the Yak Panzer, but sadly, he lacks the resources, so get away. And he could try using cautious movement now and basically hope that can get it away, but I'd not bet on it. Shot again, failed to penetrate even in that range, and there we go. Yak Panzer 4's armor was nothing there to the 122mm gun of the IS-2. Veteran D5 on the Flak Panzer, I think that's the first hit on the propaganda cast. A very dangerous vehicle as it does gain increased range on that thing. That's definitely going to be a problem here with Port Infantry, and that's, by the way, bled up pretty heavily. I mean, he could try for a third IS-2 or maybe some T-35s, but overall, I mean, there are a few problems here for Paul at the moment. And Jason has managed to maintain a large amount of infantry. The problem is, of course, the IS-2s. I mean, he does have a spare punch at quarters now, so he could try and play here for the Panther, and that will probably be my suggestion. Certainly would take a bit of longer time, but overall, I think it would have a bit more utility in the long run with what with its higher penetration and higher armor and better mobility. The only advantage the Yak Panzer 4 really has over the Panther is basically a slightly better range. But otherwise, we've noticed that doesn't really do much there if you can't penetrate with it. Which again, the Yak Panzer 4 hardly does against Soviet heavy armor. Still, the fighting is increasing around the victory points as Paul gets a bit more desperate. But never desperate enough to go for this one. And continuing up with the spare punch at the quarters round. Veteran here for the Student Pioneer will definitely help out. Jesselyn. And we see a second Yak Panzer here for Jesselyn and Deutschland. The Panzerjägerabteilung of the division apparently providing more here for the fight at the front line. So apparently no Panthers can be mobilized from any nearby divisions to support the Brandenburger Panzergrenadier Division. And we got the IS-2 falling back. Though again, Veteran T2 notably more lethal towards both the infantry and armor. Jesselyn needs to be careful though with his IS-2. I mean, to lose a Veteran T5, not his IS-2, but Flak Panzer. I mean, to lose that would definitely be a rather tragic situation. Could result in a bit of reversal there for Paul, though his forces are still heavily depleted. And then we got the second Jagdpanzer arriving through the blizzard, hoping it arrived to the right part of the front. And Jesley here basically paranoid, attacking the ground, worried something might attack through the blizzard. But there's absolutely nothing up here, not even snowmen. Fire pit up there. Jaeger's hanging about here, might soon encounter some conscripts. Getting more snipers there for Paul. He's not getting more infantry, just snipers and support units, it would seem. And he's definitely not getting more armor, which he otherwise could have done. So I'm not entirely sure what he's actually bothering with us now, but he could have said getting a third IS-2 or another or a pair of T-35s, which I actually think he could basically then, with the IS-2s, crush Jesselyn. Since Jesselyn simply had nothing to withstand that kind of firepower, but instead he goes for snipers and other things like that. And there we go, IS-2s up there on the Flakpanzer. Flakpanzer, though, barely avoids that one, but not the anti-tank grenades. Jaeger suffering as well, gaining its 23. Jagdpanzer getting a shot there through. One heavily damaged though, the other one notably less. And then they're all largely once more abandoned by Paul here. He's interesting enough, not really putting a lot of attention towards the victory points here. And never really did.
Fields promotion! Grenadiers ready. Infantry attacking in force! Grenadiers ready.
Using the victory. And there we go, the Flakpanzer rushes forward, trying to catch those snipers, and there we go. Almost gets them both. At least in one of the sniper teams. It looks like he's using the Flakpanzer to bait forward. There, the eyes two into the line of fire of the Jagdpanzer.
Target captured. No enemy contact.
And he's enough. There's been some really attempt there, I think, from Jesselyn towards laying down booby traps. I think we could do a lot, again, to further make it more difficult for Paulia to move about on the field. In particular, if you consider Paul's current force composition. Victory point-wise, he's definitely falling behind here and really need to do something to sort of change things up. He can't really maintain this kind of victory point pressure.
Standing by. Send orders.
65 kills on this Flakpanzer. That is definitely Knight's Cross level stuff. A Flakpanzer ace. Having never shot down a single aircraft, and there's then plenty of death to the infantry.
Contact!
And certainly plenty of snipers. Got the country there getting pummeled. Snipers once more creeping forward. So this time, note here, Paul's a lot more cautious with the Flakpanzer around. Looks like you did get some anti-tank gun crew. Jaeger's there dodging quite the shot. Snipers less so. There he goes straight into a heavy line of anti-tank fire there. Rockets, Jagdpanzer, Jagdpanzer, they're getting straight attacked there by the IS-2s. Gaining veterans one, but I don't think it's going to get out of there much longer. And there we go. Two veterans, two IS-2s need to get that one out of there. He's taking the longer route. He's home. There's nothing there, but of course, there's a small chance, I suppose, a flak shot there. Penetrates the rear. Of course, the Fox was there, pierced with a puncher trick. And there we go. IS-2 almost made it, but lucky Dieter there got it. Other IS-2 there close to veterans, he flee. Of course, the question is, what will Jesselyn do now? Field them recruit. I assume we head to Demon Academy for shots flying. Field, oh, the Academy over there. Barely left working.
Enemy flanking us.
So we've got the snipers there applying pressure. Again, they've wrecked. And we've still got that Flakpanzer moving about with 71 kills. There go more damage to the eyes too. Jesselyn sending in everything he can to finish it off. Maybe deliver a crushing blow here too. And oh! Flakpanzer straight into the conscripts. Anti-tank grenades there going off. Now I'm once hiding in down, but we've got the snipers now providing a bit more proper covering fire. Forcing Jeslin to break off the pursuit. And he needs to do this vehicle crew self-repairs right now. He needs to speed it up. He needs to get it back in the fight as soon as possible. I mean, the points are not looking good here for Paul at all. There we go. We got a third Jagdpanzer on the way here for Jeslin. A third one. And at this point, you kind of wonder, you need to talk about the definition of insanity or something. Anyways, eyes two there moving ahead, grenades going off. They are down to 10 points. Crew, get ready. Points falling, but victory point wise, I don't think Paul can make it anymore. Down to 2-1, and he's got not got the point secured. And GG, game over, a loss here to the Soviet Union, a victory for Germany and the Flak Panzer Ace. That one definitely stood out here, ended up doing a ton of damage to Paul, killing many snipers and a lot of infantry. That was definitely, I think, the core unit in this battle. Otherwise, a lot of units basically got wiped out several times, and the Jagdpanzers only at one point managed to reach Veterani 2 and never anything further beyond that before being properly wrecked there by the IS-2s. The problem, I think, with Paul was, in part, again, there was a sort of lack of sort of real aggression here towards the north several times since towards, you know, securing more victory points here, which overall gave Jeslin a bit of an easier time basically forming up a defence and holding back Paul. Also, I think more fuel cash would have been out earlier, and I think he should have tried to get out more armor. I mean, in that regard, you know, again, he only got two IS-2s, he never said try to get some T-35s to sort of augment the first one. I think that also would have benefited a bit more with sort of some more mobile elements. So in that regard, I think that was also a mistake there by Paul, if you will. More mines would also have been beneficial. Again, there were very few of those, and only one demo charge. In that regard, he did very little sort of really restrict the movement of Jeslin, if possible. So there were some concerns there. And I definitely think he might also want to do a bit more here from the support bomb company. There's basically one field gun. That was it. I mean, he would have done more from that. For Jeslin, I mean, that first flak half tank there was definitely a bit wasted, and beyond the first Jagdpanzer, I mean, the other thing, I really should think he should have gone for a Panther. That would easily have done a lot better there versus Paul. Instead, the other one was basically wasting. The third one never came about. But beyond that, some nice play there. The Flak Panzer turned out to be a beautiful decision. They're really doing a lot of damage. Good infantry play, some alright mines, but not a lot there. But overall, Jeslin managed to keep his opponent off guard several times throughout the battle, and certainly managed to cope there with two snipers going around killing his men. So overall, nicely played there by Jeslin, nicely played. So there you go, I hope you enjoyed this match. If you did, why not subscribe to your friends, share it with everyone. If not, you know, send in a replay on or write some feedback in the comments section. If you feel like supporting the Propaganda Cast, consider donating. There's a link in the video description where you can provide a small amount of money there for me if you like it, or a big one. I mean, I won't mind big. Via PayPal for those who do so, wish to do so. Otherwise, that's quite alright. But anyways, thank you all for watching, and see you all another time. Bye.